45 and intra-group transactions. We deal first with the prerequisites if you're to qualify for relief under Section 45. The first and primary requirement is that the transfer and the transferee must be group companies at the end of the day of the transaction. If the assets are held as capital assets by the transferor company, they must be acquired as capital assets by the transferee. If the assets are held as trading stock by the transferor, they must similarly be acquired as trading stock by the transferee company. You must ordinarily, in the wake of a Section 45 intra-group transaction, maintain that group relationship which existed between transferor and transferee companies for 6 years after the rollover. If, subject to some exceptions, you breach that group relationship within 6 years, it is the transferee company that will be taken to have disposed of its assets at their market value at the time that the transaction was concluded. Okay? Now that is a severe penalty. Okay? There is an exception to the 6 year rule. If the group relationship between transferor and transferee is severed within the 6 year period, but the severance of the group relationship is attributable to the winding up or deregistration of either of the transferor or transferee companies, you will not be subject to a deemed disposal of the transferred assets at market value. Okay? Now, in and around the 6 year rule, there is something that those of you who are auditors need to be mindful of. If you are acting for a client who is purchasing shares in a subsidiary company, there is a question you must ask as part of your tax due diligence review conducted for the buyer of the shares in the subsidiary company. You must ask whether at any time in the preceding 6 years, an asset was transferred intra-group into the subsidiary company which your client wants to acquire. Because if there had been such a transfer within the past 6 years, when your client then acquires the shares in the subsidiary, what's going to happen? Group relationship severed, deemed disposal by the newly acquired company of the previously transferred asset. And who's going to bear the cost of that? Your client. Okay? And unless you cautioned your client and pointed this out to him, look to your professional indemnity insurance. It's the question you must ask. Now, I've seen some dirty tricks in this context. Yeah? You sometimes have a difficulty in concluding a transaction involving business assets. The buyer's preference is for a direct acquisition of the assets, not the shares in the company, because he doesn't want to be confronted with any hidden liabilities of a company. The seller is only prepared to sell shares. The seller then, astutely, perhaps, says to the buyer, okay, look, let's resolve this. I transfer all these assets into a clean company, no tax history. Yeah? You buy the shares then in the clean company. What the seller does is he transfers the assets to a new company within the group, Section 45 relief. Buyer buys the shares. Problem. Watch out for it. Okay? The clean company, it ain't clean. It's thoroughly dirty. That is a thoroughly dirty maneuver. Yeah? Okay? There's some key exclusions from the operation of Section 45. It will not apply if the consideration for the transfer of assets takes the form of an issue of equity shares. That is properly the terrain covered by Section 42. It will not apply if the transferred asset is a share distributed by the transferor to the transferee. That is properly the subject of an unbundling transaction, and that is where you are to seek your rollover relief. It will not apply if the asset is distributed to pursuant to a liquidation distribution. Okay? And distribution, as I pointed out early this morning, implies a transfer of assets for less than full consideration. Okay? If you transfer the assets at market value to a holding company, again, that is not a distribution. It's not a Section 47 liquidation distribution. It is a Section 45 intra-group transaction. And lastly, Section 45 will not apply if the parties agree that it is not to apply. Okay? Now, presently, and as from 1st April this year, if a company within a group acquires an asset pursuant to a Section 45 intra-group transaction, and there is debt created at the level of the transferee company in conjunction with the transfer of the assets, such as might happen if the asset is transferred on loan account. Yeah? Section 23N will impose stringent limitations on the deductibility of interest on that debt. Yeah? Now, Section 23N operates to impose stringent limitations on interest deductibility, not only where debt is created pursuant to a Section 45 maneuver, but whenever an asset is acquired pursuant to any of the corporate rules. Okay? What Section 23N does is to require the company to adjust its taxable income. It is to calculate its adjusted taxable income. And you can bet your boots that its adjusted taxable income will be substantially lower than its ordinary taxable income. And you may not claim interest deductions in excess of your adjusted taxable income. Yeah? If you are, for example, a property holding company, in arriving at your adjusted taxable income, you can only take into account 75% of your rental income. And I can see you've been through all of this. Yeah? Now, Section 23N is a very complex provision. Yeah? You have to approach it on a case-by-case basis. Yeah? Because the rules are going to yield a wide variety of outcomes depending on the circumstances. Yeah? Arriving at that adjusted taxable income is something that I would never individually attempt to do. It's a job for auditors. Yeah? Okay. Too complicated for the likes of me. Okay. Now, Section 23N replaces an earlier provision, Section 23 capital K, and pardon me, 23K vir grootkak. Yeah? Under Section 23K, if you wanted to claim interest deductions pursuant to a rollover maneuver, what you had to do was obtain SARS pre-approval. But such a pre-approval process is cumbersome, and its outcome is inherently uncertain. There was a wide degree of discretion afforded to SARS under Section 23K, which makes for uncertainty in relation to the application of the law. And that is not a desirable state of affairs. So it's replaced by Section 23N, which gives you hard and fast rules determining the extent to which you can deduct interest on debts created pursuant to a rollover maneuver. Now, there is some interest as to why SARS introduced firstly 23K and then now 23N. The introduction of these restrictive measures owes itself to a maneuver commonly called a debt pushdown. Yeah? And if you're not familiar with debt pushdowns, I'd be happy to explain a debt pushdown to you. Okay. I see nods which say, yes, please. A debt pushdown owes its development, if you like, to a difficulties companies have or had when they borrow money in order to fund a takeover. A raider has its eyes on a target company. It borrows the necessary funds to mount the takeover from the bank. Yeah? At the level of the raider, you have a problem. You cannot get an interest deduction in respect of a stream of dividend income on the shares you bought. What was done by way of a so-called debt pushdown involved the raider firstly establishing a new wholly owned subsidiary, NewCo on your diagram. With NewCo in place, NewCo and the target company would engage in an agreement of purchase and sale. Under that agreement of purchase and sale, NewCo would acquire all the assets of the target against an assumption of liabilities and as the balance of the purchase price, the creation of a loan account. Now that loan account amount would represent net asset value, would correspond to the price the raider paid for the shares in the target. Yeah? Your next step in this unfolding story is that NewCo would now go to the bank and borrow from the bank at interest a sufficient sum to discharge its loan account liability in favor of the target company. Thereupon, the target company would be wound up, and in the course of winding up, it would distribute the sale proceeds, yeah, to the raider. The raider is now sitting with a sum coinciding with the sum originally borrowed from the bank. It repays the bank. Where's your only debt now? It's the level of NewCo. NewCo incurred that debt in acquiring income-producing assets. In principle, yeah, it should be entitled to an interest deduction on that debt. Maneuver is called a debt pushdown because the debt, which originally lay at the level of the raider, was pushed down to the level of NewCo, was transformed into a debt on which interest qualifies for a tax deduction, or would so qualify, subject currently to the stringent limitations imposed by Section 23N. In essence, yeah, if your recipient company, yeah, is already heavily geared, yeah, forget about interest deductions. Okay. All right. Any questions there? It's, I think, at least interesting to deal with an application of Section 45 to also facilitate black share co-ownership. Under this approach, one would first of all, if it's not already in place, establish a holding company between the current shareholders in an operating company and that operating company. So initial Section 42 rollover, you establish a holding company. The holding company then establishes a wholly owned subsidiary, NewCo. NewCo and OpCo, the old company, enter into an asset sale agreement. OpCo sells all its assets to NewCo against an assumption of liabilities and the creation of a loan account. If you now look at the balance sheet of NewCo, yeah, on the one hand you have assets at market value. On the other hand you have those liabilities which were assumed by NewCo, which previously attached to the transferred assets. For the balance, you've got a further liability, the loan account liability. The two should line ball. Net asset value, nil. You are now again in the position where you have a nil net asset value company, and it can proceed with an issue of shares to a black workers trust or black investor for nominal consideration. Now, while you get substantially similar outcomes, whether you proceed to do a BEE ownership deal under Section 42 or Section 45, there is generally a client preference for the Section 42 maneuver. Why would that be?
You don't have to transfer the business and you don't have to wait
6 years. Yeah, there is no business disruption. Yeah? Under the Section 42 approach, the operating company continues to trade as ever. Under this approach, involving a transfer of all business assets from one company to another, there is significant disruption. New tax registrations, new VAT registration, new bank accounts, renegotiation of contracts with suppliers and customers. Yeah? A lot of red tape. Okay? Section 42 approach is operationally much cleaner. Okay. All right. You'll see in this example, we've limited the extent of minority participation in UCO to 30%. 25% BE component, 5% to executives, to management. We can't go beyond 30% outside participation because that would breach the group relationship. Well, perhaps we can, if we arrange things somewhat differently. Yeah? Arranging things somewhat differently involves using two tiers of subsidiaries. We don't only have one NewCo, we have a further NewCo, NewCo 2, depending from NewCo 1. Initially, HoldCo holds 100% in NewCo 1, and NewCo 1 holds 100% in NewCo 2. Against that background, OpCo transfers its assets pursuant to Section 45 to NewCo 2. Qualifying intra-group transaction, because you've got your minimum 70% linkage at every step. What we then do is we issue, say, a 30% shareholding out of NewCo 2 to our BEE shareholders. But to allow also for significant management participation, at the level of NewCo 1, we issue a further percent to our key executives. Yeah? What will the effective participation of the key executives be in the enterprise conducted by NewCo 2? It'll be 30% times 70%, 21%. Okay? And the BEE guys hold 30% direct in NewCo 2. All in all, you've got minority interests in the group running to 51%. But you've not breached the grouping rules, yeah? And HoldCo has maintained control all the way down to NewCo 2. Okay? All right. Questions on that?